Precipitation reactions are any reaction that result in solid formation in a chemical reaction. So we would go from a clear solution, more than likely, and a solid would form that would precipitate, like precipitation and snowfall, rain, whatnot, would fall out of solution and collect at the bottom of the container. Okay, so we're driving the reaction via solid formation. Many times in most textbooks and in most general chemistry courses, and in my course, we discuss precipitation reactions in context of displacement or double replacement reactions, also called metathesis reactions. An example of one of those, we have lead-2-nitrate reacts with potassium sulfide in water. And so there are three steps to analyzing a reaction of this type. So we've learned nomenclature of ionic compounds, and so that's what we have here. Two ionic compounds that are dissolved in water, and that's important, as we'll see. And so the first thing we have to do is write a balanced equation from the word problem. And so we've learned most of our elemental symbols by now. So we've got lead-2-nitrate. And so we know from the polyatomic ion nomenclature that nitrate's NO3 minus. Lead-2 means 2 plus. So if we cross those, the 2 plus goes to 2 here. 1 minus goes to 1 lead. And we've got our lead-nitrate formula unit. And so we know that's aqueous, so we tag it with its phase, and then we say what else reacts but potassium sulfide. Potassium is a group 1 metal. Sulfide is in group 6, so it takes a 2 minus charge. So 2 goes to potassium, 1 goes to sulfide. We don't need to write the 1, and we don't need to write the charges when we put those together. We do need to note that the reaction again is in water. And so then we say, what are our products? Well, in a double replacement reaction, we exchange partners. So we're going to put lead and sulfur together. 2 plus, 2 minus, 2 and 2 can be simplified to 1 and 1. And so they have charge balance here. And we don't know the phase yet. And then we say, well, what about potassium and nitrate? Well, we put those together. They are 1 plus and 1 minus, so they go 1 to 1 as well. And so we have to learn to determine these phases. We have to learn the solubility rules. And so I've prepared a table here of solubility rules for those who don't have access to their textbook. I will generally caution that if you're not in my course, a lot of these rules for solubility are subjective to just how soluble something is, so the rules can differ. Generally, this is the way I organize the solubility rules. And so we have two tables here. We have a usually soluble, and we have a usually insoluble. And so compounds containing the ions nitrate, acetate, the halides, ClBr minus, I minus. So if we have halogens symbolized by just a generic X, they form a 1 minus charge, and they can be, well, let's go ahead and write it out. F minus, Cl minus, Br minus, and I minus. And generally fluorine has a lot more exceptions than just these three, but chlorine, bromine, and iodine, these are pretty good rules for the exceptions. So what are the exceptions? Well, compounds containing those four ions are usually soluble, except for when they form ionic compounds with the exceptions seen on the right. Okay, and so what we have to look at then are also the usually insoluble compounds, except for their exceptions. And so when we form a precipitate, if we form a precipitate, we are looking for these compounds and these compounds. Okay, we want to know what's not soluble, what does not stay in solution. So if we look in our problem, we have sulfide, which has no exceptions, or has the exceptions of the ammonium, the group 1 cation, so sodium, potassium, we said lithium, rubidium, cesium, francium. Okay, so we've got all of those in group one that are exceptions. Then calcium, strontium, barium. Well, if we look at our compound here, sulfide with lead is not an exception, so it forms the precipitate. It is not soluble. Potassium nitrate, nitrates usually soluble with no exceptions. Okay, so it's going to be soluble, and so it stays aqueous. Something that's soluble stays in the aqueous form. Okay, but insoluble, it precipitates. So we have to memorize the solubility rules in order to make these predictions and to write the balanced equation. Once we have the balanced equation, the next step to analyze this equation is to write the total ionic equation. And so anything that's aqueous, we break it up. And anything that has multiple, say a polyatomic ion here, nitrate, has two of those nitrates in the formula unit. Well, we can bring a two out to the coefficient. So that two, when we make it soluble, it goes from being one lead nitrate to be, well, lead two nitrate to being two nitrate ions. Okay, so a quick aside there to kind of explain why that happened. And likewise with potassium, we have two of them. Sulfide, two minus, we have just one. Anything that's aqueous breaks up, but lead sulfide's a precipitate, it does not break up. Have we balanced the equation? Oop, no, we haven't. So we have to make sure that we still have two potassium ions and two nitrates on the right-hand side of the equation, because we have two and two here as well. So we have to balance that equation. And so when we do that, we end up with two potassium ions and then two nitrate ions. So anything that's on both sides of the equation in the total ionic equation gets crossed out. Okay, so suppose we look and we see we have two nitrates on both sides. So we can cancel those out. We have two potassium ions on both sides. We can cancel those out. Those are called spectator ions. And so for the net ionic equation, we have to cancel those. Okay, we have to cancel spectator ions. And that leaves us with the net ionic equation of lead 2 ion plus sulfide ion, that those partners find each other in solution once we mix the two solutions, pour two beakers, one with lead nitrate, one with potassium sulfide together, and when that happens, very fast reaction that precipitates lead sulfide. So the net ionic equation is the only thing that's actually going on. The only process that's occurring is lead meets sulfur, the two ions meet each other, and we form the precipitate. Okay, so key things: we have to know how to form that precipitate, we have to know the solubility rules, we have to be able to write the balanced equation accounting for what precipitates, and then we have to be able to break up and identify the spectator ions in the total ionic equation in order to find the net ionic equation.